James. All right, so great job everyone with day two in terms of proposing diagnostics and treatments. You guys definitely identified a lot of the things that are less invasive and things that you could do either sooner so that you could get a better sense for what was going on. So a couple of clarifications in some of the responses that I was looking through. Something like a CT scan, a regular CT scan, not like the virtual endoscopy kind of thing that we were talking about in class where you're taking high resolution pictures and then piecing them back together. A regular CT scan doesn't help you so much as far as figuring out where a bleed might be. It could help you in terms of identifying if you have a big mass in your abdomen and you're like, oh, that might be cancer. So that can be helpful in that sense. And then barium x-rays are kind of what traditionally was done maybe 20 to 30 years ago. And it's not really invasive in the sense that you're swallowing the contrast dye and then just shooting some x-rays. So it's not actually that big of a deal to do a barium contrast study. But I think as everyone identified, the next step was really to do some kind of endoscopy, whether the pill capsule kind or the push or kind of double balloon enteroscopy to reach the places that you're not able to see in the standard endoscopy that most hospitals have. Oh, let's see. That's weird. It's backwards. So anyway, so Miss S, she was sent for capsule endoscopy. And so right now, most insurances and most institutions actually don't necessarily have access to this latest technology. And so she was sent for the capsule endoscopy. And it revealed that there was an abnormal collection of veins and arteries toward the end of her small intestine. And that's what's known as an arteriovenous malformation. And so I don't think that was in anyone's differential diagnosis, but that's something that can certainly happen in the GI tract where there's an abnormality in the blood vessels that can bleed in one's GI tract. So given this diagnosis, Ms. S is offered the option of undergoing open surgery or double balloon enteroscopy to ablate the bleeding. And so she gets it done endoscopically. So this is a picture of what one might see through the scope. And there are different ways in which, in the endoscope, you can stop the bleeding by kind of ablation. So if you've ever seen something cauterized, and what that means is that you apply heat, and there's different ways of doing that. So in this case, they typically use argon gas, which they ignite, and so you don't actually touch the surface of the mucosa. And what you do instead is you kind of inject that gas and ignite it, and that provides the heat to ablate it. Other ways that it could be done is using multipolar electrocautery when there's two kind of electrical contacts, and you touch the skin, and that provides an electrical circuit which you can deliver electricity and thus heat through that to ablate the bleeding. And currently there are other methods that are being investigated. So those are certainly things that you can discuss as far as looking at this problem from a bioengineer's perspective. So as far as diagnosis and treatment go, I think the things that are pretty interesting in this field are determining how do we treat things emergently, whether it's an acute problem or a chronic problem. For Ms. S, it was kind of subacute as far as it was happening over the span of a few months, but she had lost so much blood that she was becoming symptomatic. And so typically, the way doctors learn about gastrointestinal bleeding is to classify it, okay, is it happening in the upper GI tract, as in the stomach or the small intestine, or is it in the lower GI tract, as in the colon? And you can get to both of those places either from the top or from the bottom. But before double balloon enteroscopy, there wasn't a great way of accessing that kind of hard-to-reach middle part. And if you couldn't do it endoscopically, you'd either have to do it through either open surgery or, in certain cases, if the patient is stable enough, you can do laparoscopic surgery. And so there are many causes, as you guys identified on day one. Ulcers are very common. Vascular malformations are less common, but still something to consider. And cancer is something that you would always want to rule out and make sure that that's not happening. One of the other things that some groups mentioned is angiography. And so what that is injecting dye, radio contrast dye, into either the veins or arteries, and that can help show you where the bleeding is occurring. And typically you access the patient's vessels through the groin, and so you pass these devices like a wire through the groin, and then that allows you access into the vessels. You inject the dye, and then you shoot the x-ray while you're in the catheter lab where they're doing these studies. But this assumes that the bleeding is constant enough that you would actually see this in real time, and that would help you identify where the bleed is occurring. And sometimes you can even, depending on where the bleed is, you can use angiography to also treat things as well, but that's not the preferred way of doing things. Certainly if you have a bleeding vessel in the liver where the blood vessels are more directly accessible from the aorta as you go up from the groin, you can use ablation techniques through the vessel as well. So that's one thing to consider. So there's lots of things to think about here, and then kind of propose as far as any aspect of this case, as far as diagnosis to treatment, and definitely, so I think after reviewing everyone's kind of proposed diagnostic studies and tests and treatments, everyone scored full points. So really great job on that on day two. So we'll be curious to hear what you have for day three.